talk noise, okay? Come on up, Mike. You're going to open us up today.
What am I doing?
You're going to open us up with prayer, brother.
All right. Good afternoon. We're getting ready to start. Father God, oh, how you love us. Oh, how you love us, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for all that you do. Thank you for your presence, Lord. Thank you for the peace that you give us. Thank you for the Holy Spirit, Lord. Thank you, Lord, as we gather here to worship you, to lift you up, to glorify your name. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thanks, Mike. All right, we're going to get started. Are you ready?
We're ready.
All right. Scott's got a guy sitting at the table named Larry Rice.
Okay. Uh-huh.
And when you get to, how many numbers you gonna do today?
I don't know, whatever.
Why don't you go ahead and do about four?
Okay.
Then call and say, yeah, we got a great brother. I'll do it either one. Larry Rice, let him come up and
sing.
Do a number.
All right.
Got it.
Amen.
I'm always
good to see you, brother.
Good afternoon. We were in Philippians 3 last week, and we were cut kind of short, so I want to pick up where we were. In verse 12, chapter 3 of Philippians, not that I've already obtained all of this, or have already been made perfect. I got to move here. I'm getting cross-eyed. But I press on to take hold of that which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it. But one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining towards what is ahead, I press on towards the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. All of us who are mature should take such a view of things. And if on some point you think differently, that too God will make clear to you. Only let us live up to what we have already attained. Join with others in following my example, brothers, and take note of those who live according to the pattern we gave you. Remember, this is Paul talking, not me. For as I have often told you before, and now say again, even with tears, many live as enemies of the cross of Christ. Their destiny is destruction, their God is their stomach, and their glory is their shame. Their mind is on earthly things, but our citizenship is in heaven. And we eagerly await a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ, who, by the power that enables him to bring everything under his control, will transform our lowly bodies so that they will be like his glorious body. Therefore, my brothers, you whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, that is how you should stand firm in the Lord. Dear friends, I'm trying to get through this, my tags on this Bible, so I want to go ahead into chapter 4. He says, starting with verse 4, rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and petition with thanksgiving. Present your request to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, but put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. He goes further down in verse 17, for what I am looking for what may be credited to your account. Verse 19, and my God will meet all your needs according to his glorious riches in Christ Jesus. Praise be to God. Amen. Jesus is coming.
Oh, You lead me. I could hold on to who I am and never let you change me from the inside. And I could be safe. I could be safe here in your arms and never leave home. Never let these walls down. But you have called me high.
Was grace that taught my soul to fear, and grace my fears relieved. God's grace appear. The eye I first believe.
My chains
are gone. I've been set free.
My God, my Savior. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord.
So when we've been there 10,000 years, and we're bright and shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing His praise. And the day we first began,
my chains are gone.
I've been set free. My Lord,
you ransomed me,
and like a flood, God's mercy. Amazing grace, my chains. Unending love. His love never ends, it keeps on going. Lord, you're there forever and ever and ever and ever. Your love never ends, it never fades, it never grows dim. It never gets weaker, Lord. It's just amazing.
Amazing grace.
I believe we got someone in our audience today that we're going to ask them to come and give us a number. Is there a Mr. Larry Rice in the house? Mr. Rice, would you come on up, please? Amen. Amen. So what do we do?
We're with you. You tell us. We're going to follow you.
You know the song Danny Boy?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. It's good. He looked beyond my faults and saw my nature.
Oh, Danny Boy.
I don't know what key. Let's just find one.
Pick a note. Sing a note. We'll find it.
Amazing grace. Yeah. You want to help me?
Yes.
All right. Well, this is a surprise, and we'll find out how big a surprise here. Let me just check you out just for a minute. You know, there's some people that look then there's some people that see. And I'm at that point where I'm wanting to see like God sees people. God looks on our hearts. He looks past those things that some people can't get past. He looks beyond all those things that are our blemishes, our scars. Anybody got a scar?
Yes, sir.
You know what that's a testimony of? The healing grace of God. Every scar that you bear in your spirit or in your body is evidence that the healer has taken note of your hurt. Well, let's see how this sounds. If you know the song, you sing it with me. It goes like this. Amazing grace shall always be my song of praise. For it was grace that bought my liberty. I do not know just why he came to love me so. He looked beyond my faults and saw my needs. I shall forever lift mine eyes to Calvary to view the cross where Jesus died for me and you. How marvelous the grace that caught my falling soul. He looked beyond my fault and saw my need. What scripture I love. He looked beyond our faults. In fact, your heavenly Father knows exactly what you need even before you ask him. That's in his word. It's true. I shall forever lift mine eyes to Calvary to view the cross where Jesus died for me. How marvelous the grace that caught my falling soul. He looked beyond my faults and saw my need. What I needed was Jesus.
We're not quite finished yet. There's another brother sitting out there by the name of Nicky. Nicky, come on up, brother. Come on up, Nicky. Give Nicky a hand.
Amen. Amen. Larry Rice is a good friend of mine. Unless he gave my name to you, then I'm. He's having nothing to do with it. Yeah. How about B flat? Is that okay? Guitar. It's not a good guitar key, but
yeah, B flat's fine.
It's okay. Oh Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder Consider all the words thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. With shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble
next number, we got Guy Brown, we got Jim Williams, and we got A.C. Musgrove and Bill Williams. You guys, what are y'all going to sing? You know, guys, let me tell you something. It is so awesome when you get people who can really sing to come in and sing. And God, we didn't qualify. I mean, we didn't make that cut, brother. We got cut way before time. But that was so awesome. Was that not awesome? One more time. Amen. You know, last week we had, I want to ask Dee Dee to come up. She got a letter from Michael. And you know, Michael's incarcerated. We talked last week, we prayed, and there are 12 men in the prison who got baptized. But I want you to listen to this letter, because this letter ought to be a conviction to each one of us. There's things going on in the prison where men and women are getting set free, they don't have the distractions and all a lot of stuff that we deal with. And they get serious about the faith. And so when Dee Dee shared this with me, I said, Dee Dee, I think you need to read this.
Well, I told Smokey I didn't know if I could read it without crying, because that's
okay. Enjoy yourself.
That's what I did when I read it last night when I opened the mail. This was written by the young man, Stephen Soto, that my husband led to Christ, that the Lord put on the top bunk above him, and Stephen saw Michael reading his Bible all the time. And he's so cute. He's 29 years old, and he put press release. I love it. This isn't going to the press, but it's going to you. And I gave most of you a copy of it, so you can reread it. Just so you know, at the bottom of the second page, that name that you can't understand is Alistair Begg. He didn't know how to spell it, and I meant to white that out before.
Can you speak louder, please?
Yes, I can speak louder. I can get closer. I'll just have to do this. While Christ-centered, evangelistic Great Commission-focused churches are unheard of across the country's Federal Bureau of Prisons, the Fishers of Men at FMC, which stands for Federal Medical Center, Devens, have decided to break ground. With an intentional focus on the Great Commission, the Fishers of Men Prison Ministry baptized a combined 12 people on April 18, 2015. And as you saw in the pictures last week, it was in about 6 or 7 foot size blow-up pool, a kid's blow-up pool. We are truly blessed to have had the privilege to bear witness to a living God, answering our prayers and working through us to accomplish his will, said Stephen Soto, an inmate and lead evangelist of the prison ministry. The Fishers of Men strategy is what they call the Great Commission Purpose-Driven Prison Ministry, inspired by God and Rick Warren's purpose-driven church structure. It took nearly 2 years of prayers, fellowshipping, fasting, advocating, rebuking, structuring, and waiting patiently on the Lord to open up doors for us to be effective fishers of men, Pedro Hernandez, co-pastor of the ministry, said. Stephen said that in the federal prisons, baptism is a sticky issue to navigate. It's a challenge to lead people to Christ to begin with, he said. People in prison worship counterfeit gods from every possible false religion that exists, making the evangelistic outreach experience feel like you are fishing for souls right in the pits of hell. But once Stephen is able to share the good news of Jesus Christ with the inmates, he said, they always respond. Michael Signoretto, who's my husband, a member of First Baptist Dallas, said this is a game changer for federal prison ministries. I believe there are a lot of inmates who will have a real opportunity to repent and accept Christ and become purpose-driven Christians. So far, there have been over 30 men who've given their lives to Christ in Michael's unit, and there's 132 men. The quote goes on, I have personally witnessed Stephen and the church here effectively witness to lost souls here against all odds, and it has been a true blessing to watch the hand of God anointing these faithful brothers in Christ in this dark place. Signoretto also noted that inmates who follow this structure in other federal prisons will have great success in winning souls for the kingdom of Christ. You can't expect inmates who have been worshiping a false god for years to be immediately receptive to the good news, said Stephen. It takes us being consecrated Christians and showing them the love of Christ daily, and only then does God soften a hard heart, allowing us to penetrate the living word of God and allow Jesus to transform another life. A big part of our DNA is loving the lost and unbelievers unconditionally and meeting their physical needs regardless of their crime or religious belief, Pedro said. I know that the souls are dehydrated and in desperate need of a savior. Our job is to be faithful servants and demonstrate to them that only Jesus Christ holds the key that shall set them free. Stephen says God has answered all his prayer requests to use him for ministry. God has been faithful to me and to the church here. I thank the Lord daily for blessing me with spiritual parents, Michael and Dee Dee Signoretto. These two faithful servants of Christ have been crucial to my spiritual growth. Dee Dee has been a lifeline communicating the miracles God is doing with the church here, with the outside church, so that our testimony could encourage, edify, and strengthen the body of Christ, as well as put us on a 24-hour prayer tower at First Baptist Dallas, the Brooklyn Tabernacle, and at Smokey John's Barbecue in Dallas, Texas. Brother Michael has equipped me for ministry by discipling me and providing me with Bibles, and there are men in here who have sent Bibles to Michael just for this purpose. Lost my place. Bibles and pointing me to the faithful Bible-believing bold preachers of the word like Robert Jeffress, Mac Brunson, Rick Warren, Jim Cimbala, Tim Keller, John MacArthur, Alistair Begg, the Billy Graham Evangelistic Association, Nikki Cruz, and Hope for the Heart. I have been heavily influenced by the Southern Baptist Church. Jesus used these and many other faithful Christians to show me that Christ is worth living. He's talking about you all who have prayed. He said, has shown me, Jesus Christ used these and many other faithful Christians to show me that Jesus Christ is worth living, witnessing, and dying for. We are deeply grateful for your faithfulness to Christ and your prayers, and I look forward to the day I could see you guys in person, God willing. And to Dr. W.A. Criswell, who led Michael and I to Christ, and who influenced Rick Warren immensely. I shed tears of joy every time I think of the impact you have made here on earth in Jesus' name. You are a true legend living right next to Jesus Christ, our living Lord and Savior. I love you and Mrs. Criswell. She personally discipled me. Please help Jesus organize a group of supernatural prayer warriors to pray for the church through these difficult times. And that's you all. You're the supernatural prayer warriors that have been praying for the church there in the difficult times. And I just want to ask you to continue to pray for the men, for there to be a revival there, for the warden, for the guards, for everybody in the prison, and all the inmates. Most of them are ill and dying and have really long sentences. So it's really imperative that we continue to pray. And I asked Oscar Rohn, he spoke here twice recently, if he would be willing to go to this prison where my husband is and these men, to speak to them, and he said yes. Wow. So he's written a letter to the chaplain who's been very helpful to Michael and Stephen to get the baptistry and get a Christian library going, and he is waiting for a response. So would you please pray that the chaplain and the warden, because the warden has the final say-so on everything, will allow Oscar to come and preach the gospel to these men. That's my main prayer right now. So. Thank you for praying. Keep praying.
You know, no, you can't. Come on up. Nobody up here singing it louder than this lady here.
Well, and it's funny because I get really nervous to talk. But I just really feel like I want to say something. When she's reading that letter, I'm looking around this room, and I know every single one of you, when you watch a baseball game or a basketball game or a football game, you're on your feet cheering. You're cheering. She just read a letter of people coming to Christ in the worst conditions, having made the worst choices of their lives. And if we for one second think that except by the grace of God, we're not there too, then our eyes are blinded. But you guys, get up and cheer. We got some home runs. Yeah, these are home runs. These are home runs. These are touchdowns. These are the Hail Marys. This is what it's about.
Woo. Thank you so much, dear. We needed that. We needed that. You know, we're going to do something a little bit different today. I really feel that a lot of you in here have been praying for Michael, praying for, you know, I think it ought to really increase our prayer life. I'm reading a book right now, and there was a country, I can't even think of the name of it, where these people got together and they prayed for 100 years, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. I'm trying to figure, what in the world would that look like? You know, one of the things I'm learning is that, you know, prayer is a lot more than what we make it to be. If we really understood how powerful prayer is, then we couldn't stop praying. You know, prayer moves the heart muscle of God. When we get into a fellowship and really start thinking about it, you know, I was telling a friend of mine this morning that I was praying with, and I said, you know, my grandfather, I never heard him ask for nothing from God except rain, because he was a farmer. His prayers was, God, let my grandson, my great-grandson, let my great-grandkids have a better life than what I've had. And the sad part about it, we've gotten that better life, but we've forgotten where it comes from. I mean, these guys laid on their faces. I remember my grandfather and them would have prayer meetings that would last all night long. And I was just thinking about all this rain. You see, they had no other means of survival except what they got from out of the fields, the crops. And so without rain, there was no harvest. And I can remember my grandfather calling a prayer meeting, and people up from all over the community. It didn't matter. This was before integration was integration. But it didn't make no difference whether you were black, white, or brown. You still needed rain. So whites and blacks came together to my grandfather's house, and they would get together out there, and they would start a prayer meeting. And then all of a sudden, somebody would walk up in the midst of the crowd who could sing. And one of them brothers would walk up and be something like this, boom, 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 boom. And then all of a sudden, some guy with a real high voice would come in, and he would take it to another level. And then we had a baritone that would come in. He would kick in there. And then pretty soon, everybody was singing. In a few days, we'd hear thunder, and there come rain. But when rain started, there was a praise going on all over the community. I was telling us, you know, my grandfather's friend was Mr. Dawson. Well, Mr. Dawson got real sick and couldn't work. So my grandfather got all the guys in the community. They went and plowed his field. They harvested his crop. They painted his barn. They didn't charge him one dime. And when they got through, they just went over and had a prayer time with him. And when I was a little boy growing up and go down Mr. Dawson would always take him. He knew how to get us youngsters. He would buy these jawbreaker suckers. And he'd come over, and every one of us would be waiting on him so we could get one of them suckers. And then he and my grandfather would sit out there, and they would start praying. And they would pray and encourage one another in the faith. You know, when I was listening to her read that letter, I know a lot of you in here have been praying for Micah. You know, Micah started coming to this meeting. And one day Micah came up to me and he says, Brother, would you pray for me that I want to have a spirit of boldness? And we prayed. Micah would come every week. And then he says, I want you to pray for me to have the anointing. And we prayed. And then he said, I think my wife's going to come next week. Let me tell you why I'm telling you this. Sometimes we read scripture, but we don't take time to really meditate on what that scripture is saying. And so you guys heard me say this so many times. Psalms 139, and I shared that with Dee Dee this morning. Even before the thought comes to your mind, God knows what that thought is. Not only does he know what the thought is, but he knows how you're going to react and respond to that thought. So back then when Micah was coming here, God knew that a day Micah would be there, and God would be using Micah in a way that Micah couldn't see right then. And Dee Dee called many times and said, let's just pray that God use Micah. Uh-huh. Now, let me tell you something. Every one of us sitting in this room have got somebody that we know that's on their way to hell. This letter ought to move you to want to move to a place that you can be able to get in touch with them. I was in Whole Foods Sunday. Let me tell you what, God uses all kinds of things for bait. I'm in Whole Foods Sunday. God thought about you because I was going to call it to Wallerman's Good. I'm going to give you half of it. So anyway, this guy had a Wallerman in his basket, and I had a Wallerman in the basket. And I looked at him. I said, brother, do you know if that Wallerman's any good or not? And he says, I hope so. And I said, you hope? You don't know it's good? He said, no. I said, well, brother, let me ask you another question. Do you know where you're going to spend eternity? And he said, I'm not sure. I said, see, you got the same problem with the Wallerminer as you got with eternity. Now, I can't make the Wallerminer good, but I can get you prepared for eternity. And so I turned around with him, and the people were in line, so I had a chance to lead him to Christ. Well, Libby was standing behind me, so when I left and went out of the store, Libby called me later on and told me, she went up and you invited him to come, didn't you, Libby? But let me tell you something. The Wallerminer got my attention, but God used the Wallerminer to stir up my spirit. I think everything has the opportunity. I have found out how you get rid of, you know how you get rid of solicitors who call your house? Give them a choice. Say, okay, I'm going to listen to your spiel, but when you get through, I got one I want to share with you. So tell me yours, and then I'm going to tell you mine. Right now, I think I've led 15 of those people to the Lord. And one of them called me back and got my phone number so they could call me and follow up because they said, I don't want to lose this. I want to keep understanding. Can I call you sometime? I said, anytime you get ready. You know, we have so many opportunities to be able to let God do something in us and then through us with his glory. I mean, it's so amazing to me. But the little guy had his Wallerminer, and I looked at that Wallerminer. And that Wallerminer, I said, boy, why am I looking at this Wallerminer? And that's why I get into a mind, a prayer. Why are you in the grocery line? Lord, is that one? Do you want to say something through me to that one? If you do, thank you, God, because I've been fell over in a minute. If the Holy Ghost gets it, I just start kicking it anyway. It don't make no difference. But, you know, it's like, I just want to encourage you to be excited about your faith. I'm so glad that you came up and kicked us in our back end. So we started getting up off our back end and give God some praise up in here. I like that. Get the Lord another hand clap. Amen. 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 She gets up there. Isn't that awesome? You know, let me tell you something. Come Thursday night, when they tip off, I'll be kicking chairs, knocking things over. Why? Because I'm excited about that crazy game with that little round ball, and when it's over, it won't matter who wins. Because it ain't going to be nothing, it don't mean nothing to me, but the excitement of the moment. And this was an excitement of a moment in time that here's a man and a group of men in the prison that's turning lives for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And the other part is you don't know who all going to get saved out of that. That's awesome. That's awesome. So I just want to encourage you to remember, if you're excited about your salvation, you ought to be telling somebody. You ought to be telling somebody. You know, I can't wait to tell somebody about it. I know somebody's going to get saved today. You know, I mean, that's automatic. I mean, I love the elevator when it gets in the, you know what I'm saying, like you don't know what it's going to do. I said, you know, if this elevator don't come down, where you going? It's amazing. People want to know, if the elevator don't come down and we just stuck here, what's going to happen to you? It's amazing how people respond. There are more people want to be saved than we got people that's willing to tell them how they can be saved. Aren't you glad somebody told you how to get saved? Aren't you glad somebody told you about Jesus? Then why don't you go tell somebody? Why are you being a secret agent? You know, most of us are incognito. We love being cool around Christians, walk outside and go, we like Peter. Never saw the man, don't know him. Get behind me, don't want to hear it. Get excited about it. Get excited about it. And when you leave today, leave with an attitude. There's somebody that you want to know this Jesus. I'm reading through the book of Acts right now for another time. Have you really took time to look at the church, the early church in the book of Acts? These people got filled with the Holy Spirit. They got excited about their faith. Nothing else mattered. Wherever they went, they was turning the world upside down. They didn't have cell phones. They didn't have your MacBooks or your TVs and nothing. What did they do? They went with such an enthusiasm. They were so enthused about the gospel and excited about it. They couldn't wait. That's one thing I like my sister. When she get up and get to singing, you would think she's 8 feet tall. And you barely can see her. But she got the, boy, look at, she get the same. We, you know, we went up to Aspen, Colorado, and she was on the stage up there. There was nobody up there louder than she was. I mean, she was so loud, she was shaking the place. And everybody was looking, where's that voice coming from? Well, you got to look down. You can't look up because it ain't up there. It's down here. She will make you look up and then look down. So I just want to say, guys, today is special to be able to have a copy of that letter. Take that home with you. Don't just get rid of it. And every now and then, read it. It will be an encouragement to you to be more committed about your faith. You know, and brothers, I'm going to tell y'all something. I am so grateful that you two of y'all come. Now, we're not going to close this meeting out. I am not forgot. I mean, you know, I got hands going over here, fingers going over there. You know, I mean, people are always directing me. I want you two brothers to come up, both of you, Mike, Nick, and yeah, come on up. Hey, young lady, come on up. I'm talking about, yes, you little lady. She's getting ready to go on a mission field, and we may not see us, but we're going to bless her and send her off. But I want these two guys to do a number together to close us out. Now, I mean, whatever y'all going to do. So you can get together and think it up, but you're going to have to do a number. That's all I got to say. We ain't closing out until we get this number done. Amen. Amen. Yeah, Joey. Pardon me? Okay. You going to Kenya? All right, well, come up. We'll pray for you, too. Yeah. Huh? Do you sing, dear? You sure?
I'm sure.
I was told that you had a great voice. So I'm going to let you lead these guys in whatever you want to sing.
Okay.
You want to do it?
No.
You don't want to do it?
I don't sing.
You sure?
I'm sure.
Okay, all right. She started shaking and going, no, I don't want to do this. All right. Okay, I'll figure that out. I ain't going to worry about that. Guy Brown, come up and pray over these two ladies here, would you please? And each one of you all sitting down, would you raise your hand toward them, please? Amen. Amen. She's going to Kenya, and where are you going to go now?
South Asia.
South Asia. Yeah.
Thank you. Our Father God, Lord, we praise you. We bless your name. Lord, we want to honor you. And Lord, we know in and of ourselves, we can't honor you. But Lord, we thank you that you've given us of your spirit.
Yes.
That by your spirit, by the Holy Spirit, that you are alive, living in us. And that you're our hope of glory.
Yes, Lord. Yes.
You're the hope that we have to honor you.
Yes.
And Lord, I just pray that you would help us to recognize that this life is not about us.
Yes.
But it's about you. Lord Jesus, I pray for your guidance for each of these young ladies.
Yes.
That you would be with them in the ministry that you've called them to.
Yes.
Be with Joanne in Kenya and be with this young lady and the mission field that you've called her to. We ask, Lord, that you would make it fruitful, that you would prepare the hearts even now before they come.
Yes, Lord.
That they would receive the word that you have for them.
Yes.
And I pray, God, that you would help them and the team that works with them, that they would do just as you did, Lord Jesus, in that you only said what the Father told you to say.
Amen.
And how, even how he told you to say it.
Yes.
Lord Jesus, you only did what the Father told you to do.
Yes.
And I pray in the same way that you would lead them, that they would only do what you direct them to do.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your great love for us. And Lord, we just pray that you would make their time fruitful in every way. And we ask that you would guide and direct and open every door in the way that they need open. And Lord, provide for their needs financially and otherwise. And I just pray, Lord, for those whom they would be presenting to, that you would prepare their hearts and help them to receive the word of faith. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen.
Give the Lord a hand clap, amen. All right.
I heard an old, old story how the Savior came from the lonely, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his glory, of his precious blood
song. Lead me, guide me along the way. For if you lead me, I shall not stray. Lord, let me walk each day. Along the way.
Father, we just want to say thank you for your presence here today. What an awesome time, Lord. I thank you for these two brothers, Mike, and I thank you, Lord, for brother that's come in and they was called on and they walked up and blessed us. And then, Lord, we thank you for the faithful ones that's here every week that bless us with music. We thank you, Lord, for the letter that we was able to hear what you're doing through Mike and others at the prison. And Lord, let us leave today with an attitude, Lord, that we are available and we desire for you to work in and through us today in a whole new and exciting way. Father, we ask right now that your fresh anointing would come upon everyone that's in the sound, under the sound of my voice. Because the word says when the anointing comes, it removes burdens and destroys yokes in the work of the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, have your way. Thank you for being in this place today. It's so awesome, Lord, as we watch how you move from time to time. You bring people from the north, from the east, from the west, from the south. And then, Lord, you show us what it looks like. When you start moving through people's life, no one looks around and see what neighborhood you're from or what you have or don't have. We just look and see you in the midst of what we are doing and let you get glory for it, because it's all about you and not about us. So we give you praise and honor and we glorify your name. Yeah, Lord, we ask right now, let us walk in this anointing. In Christ's name we pray, amen.
All right, I'll just wait.